Just like all living things, microbes need a source of nutrition in order to survive. They need access to the raw materials they need to build the biological macromolecules required for their survival, as well as to generate the energy they need to control their metabolic processes and their cellular processes that allow them to grow and reproduce. What may surprise you is that those nutritional requirements aren't that different from your own. But it's very important that we understand the nutritional requirements for all microbes, especially if we hope to culture them in a laboratory setting. So today we're going to talk about microbial nutrition, and in particular, how we grow microbes in a laboratory environment. So stay tuned. Hi, and thanks for tuning in. Today we're talking about microbial nutrition, and we'll also be talking about how we culture microbes in a laboratory setting. So as you would suspect, microbes are living things. And as with all living things, microbes need a source of nutrition. They need a source of the raw materials they need to create their own biological macromolecules, as well as a source of energy that allows them to power their metabolism to convert raw materials into the materials that they need to keep themselves growing, to allow them to reproduce, and allow them to survive. So no matter what organism we look at, we break down the things they require into two major classes. On one hand, the things they need in a large amount, we tend to refer to those as macronutrients. Those are things that an organism needs to take in a significant amount of on a regular basis in order to survive. There are also things that they don't need such a high amount of. These are things we refer to as micronutrients. In humans, we tend to refer to micronutrients as either vitamins or minerals. Vitamins are micronutrients that are organic in nature. They have a carbon skeleton, things like vitamin B12 or vitamin C or vitamin D. On the other hand, the things that are inorganic, we tend to refer to as minerals. So these are things like magnesium and manganese and things like that. We don't need a lot of those because they're not required for a ton of what we do, but typically they're involved as some sort of enzymatic cofactor. They allow an enzyme to function. Or for example, things like iron we need a small amount of because it's required for our hemoglobin to carry oxygen and carbon dioxide. The same thing is true of microbes. Now what's interesting is if we take something as simple and as small as an E. coli cell, and if we were to break down the constituent parts, if we were to boil it down and just sort of look at exactly what makes an E. coli cell at the molecular level, you'd be interested to find that E. coli on the whole are not that different from what we would find in a human being or any other organism. We would find, for example, that about 70% of an E. coli cell is water. And that goes for pretty much every other organism as well. Your cells are about 70% water. But if we remove that water and we just look at what we would call the dry weight, okay, the 30% that remains, about 97% of that dry weight would be in some form of organic compound. It would be some sort of compound that has a carbon skeleton. So think back to our talk about biological macromolecules, okay? It's linked here in this video. We talked about the fact that there are four major classes of biological macromolecules: lipids, proteins, nucleic acids, and carbohydrates. Well, that's about what 97% of the dry weight of pretty much all cells are, those type of molecules. If we zoom in even further and we look at that 97%, if we look at those organic molecules and we just break them down to the atoms that we'd find, we would find that 96% of the atoms we would harvest from that dry material would actually belong to just six different elements: carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, phosphorus, and sulfur. We abbreviate that CHOMPS for short. So remember that. Now the thing to remember is that those things don't typically exist in their atomic form. Almost nothing exists in a living thing in its atomic form. It exists as a compound. It exists bound to other atoms. So for example, if we're looking at a carbohydrate, we're going to be looking at a molecule that consists of carbons and hydrogens and oxygens covalently bonded to each other to create a biological macromolecule with whatever role it functions in the cell. So as I said before, all microbes, as well as all living things, need to have access to the raw materials they need in order to survive, as well as a source of energy in order to power their metabolism, which is the interconversion of those raw materials into the things that the organism needs to survive. The two biggest things that all organisms need to have a source of in their diet are energy and carbon. Since almost all macromolecules have a carbon skeleton associated with them, carbon is the key atom that all organisms need to have access to. And we break the living world down into four major categories based on the sources of those two things, based on the sources, their source of energy, as well as their source of carbon. And you can see that shown in this table. So we're gonna work our way through and talk about what each of these different types of things means. What you can see is that we typically label an organism with two different prefixes, one designating their source of energy and their other designating their source of carbon. So let's start with energy source first. Energy can come typically from two places on the planet Earth. One is from the sun. And if an organism acquires its energy from solar energy, we refer to them as a phototroph. Okay, so if we think about plants, for example, they typically get their energy from the sun. They harvest it with their chlorophyll. They are what we'd call phototrophs. On the other hand, other organisms get their energy from chemical compounds. They get it from the molecules that they ingest or acquire from their environment. Those things we label as chemotrophs. They get their energy from chemicals. You and I, for example, are chemotrophs. The energy we get to power our metabolism comes from breaking down the food that we eat. Now, the other thing we need to consider is, where do those organisms get their carbon from? There are two major sources of carbon on the planet as well. One is atmospheric carbon dioxide, and things that get their carbon by harvesting it from atmospheric carbon dioxide are labeled as autotrophs. Okay, so for example, we'll go back to plants. Plants typically get the carbon they use to make their glucose and other biological macromolecules by absorbing carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. They are what we would refer to as autotrophic organisms. Using us as another example, the opposite, we get our carbon from ingesting organic molecules. We, for example, bring in food like starch, and then we break that starch down and we can find carbon atoms that way. We are referred to as heterotrophs as a result. Now, if you want to properly label any organism on the planet, you take both of those prefixes and combine them. So let's look at plants, for example. If we look at plants or algae or even photosynthetic bacteria like cyanobacteria, where do they get their energy from? Well, they get it from the sun, so they are phototrophs. Where do they get their carbon from? They get it from atmospheric carbon dioxide, which also makes them autotrophs. So we would refer to cyanobacteria or plants as photoautotrophs. On the other hand, an animal like us, or a microbe that gets its energy the same way we do, well, they get their energy by breaking down organic compounds, which makes them chemotrophs. They get their carbon from the organic molecules that they eat, which makes them heterotrophs. We are chemoheterotrophs. That is who we are. Now, we can combine it in different ways. For example, we could look at purple bacteria. They are phototrophic in the sense that they get the energy to power their metabolism from the light. They get it from the sun, which makes them phototrophs. But they get their carbon not from atmospheric carbon dioxide. Instead, they get it from ingesting organic molecules, which makes them heterotrophs. So they are photoheterotrophs. The one thing to realize is, as long as you know what the prefixes are, as long as you know where the light comes from, or where the energy comes from, where their carbon comes from, you can properly label any organism on the planet. A lot of what we'll be talking about in terms of microbiology in the context of human health and disease, most of the things that we are going to be interested in are going to fall into the chemoheterotroph bin. And the main reason why is, if they're causing harm to you, most likely they are eating your own nutrients, they're going to be chemoheterotrophs. It's not 100% the case all the time, but they would fall into that category, typically referred to as either a parasite for the most part. So now what I want to talk about is how we use our knowledge about microbial nutrition to culture microbes in a laboratory setting. To start this conversation, I kind of want to hop in our Wayback Machine, and I want to go back to 19th century Germany. We're going to go to the Imperial Health Office, into the laboratory of Dr. Robert Koch. So Robert Koch was a microbiologist, a very early microbiologist, whose primary goal was to discover the microbial causes of disease. So right around the mid-19th century, the mid-1800s, we start to get this wealth of information about how microbes, how bacteria in particular, can cause human infections and impact human health and disease. What Robert Koch decided he wanted to do was figure out how you can assign a certain microbe to a particular disease. In other words, how do we identify a particular microbe as the pathogen associated with a particular infection or disease. Okay? The problem was microbial culturing techniques at that time were pretty raw. It wasn't particularly easy. They weren't well developed. So one of the things that happened in Robert Koch's lab as he proceeded throughout his scientific career, they made a lot of interesting discoveries and developments that are still relevant in today's microbiological labs. So for starters, the earliest methods for culturing bacteria in a laboratory setting relied on the use of gelatin. Okay, so gelatin is a plant byproduct or an animal byproduct. But one of the things I want you to think about is this. Have you ever gone to the summer barbecue and somebody, it's usually maybe a weird aunt or some distant relative that shows up with the green jello that has the fruit like embedded in it. And you're like, that's not ever going to get eaten. And it doesn't. Like one person takes a scoop out of it. And the rest of the time it spends that whole day sitting on the picnic table out in the 85 degree weather because it's summer and just gets ignored. But what happens after about 3 or 4 hours in the sun? Well, what's going to happen most likely is you're going to come back to find a bowl of green liquid with all of the little pieces of pineapple and cherries kind of floating in it, right? And the main reason why is that gelatin has a fairly low melting temperature. It melts actually below human body temperature. Now, if you're culturing environmental bacteria, using gelatin might not be a terrible idea because those are things that would grow at room temperature, right? Something that's still below the melting point of gelatin. But if you're Robert Koch and his associates, and you want him to be able to, and you want to be able to culture human pathogens, well, you need to be able to grow those at 98.6 degrees Fahrenheit or 37 degrees Celsius. And the problem is gelatin melts at that particular temperature, which makes gelatin not a very useful substance to culture potential human pathogens on. Enter a husband and wife team that worked in Dr. Koch's laboratory. Their names were Fanny and Walter Hesse. Now, Fanny was actually from New York City. She was an American. She married Walter Hesse and then began working as microbiologists in Dr. Koch's lab. So one of the things that Fanny brought to the lab was some working knowledge about gelatins. In fact, one of the things she discovered, or well, she found out, was that lots of other people were starting to use this other substance, a seaweed extract called agar, when they were making gelatin-like substances. And the cool part about agar is agar has a melting temperature that's well above human body temperatures, around 50 degrees Celsius or 60 degrees Celsius, depending on what the concentration of agar in water is. What's nice about that then is if you're going to be culturing human microbes and you're going to be incubating them at temperatures well above human body temperature, agar won't melt. And for that reason, agar, which is also indigestible by most microbes because it's basically cellulose, becomes a much more useful substance to use for microbial culture, in particular, microbial culture relevant to human health and disease. And to this day, the overwhelming majority of solid media consists of an agar in water solution to make a hardened gelatin that is useful even when studying microbes at a higher temperature, things around human body temperature. Another scientist that worked for Dr. Koch was a man named Julius Petrie. Julius Petrie recognized that it was particularly hard to study microbes and to keep them uncontaminated when you were basically growing them on gelatin or agar slabs with no protection. So what Julius Petrie developed was a glass dish that you could put the agar in, let it harden, and then a glass lid that would go over the top of it. This is something that we now refer to as the Petrie dish. They're nowadays made out of glass, but they're also made out of disposable forms that are mainly out of plastic. So in most laboratories, you're going to be dealing with plastic Petri dishes, but the dish that still bears his name is around today. And this was also developed in the late 1800s in Dr. Koch's lab in the Imperial Health Office. But there were other problems that still persisted. And while Dr. Koch's lab was also working on these particular advances, other microbiologists were trying to deal with other issues in the world of microbiology. One particular issue was the issue of specificity. So you can't just put agar in water and grow microbes on it. You have to give those microbes a source of food. Back then, most microbial culture, the food they would supply to microbes was something very similar to like a chicken or a beef broth for the most part. It had some salt, it had some proteins, carbohydrates, all the stuff that microbes need to persist. But here's the downside to that. Pretty much any microbe can eat that nutritional source. So if you're looking, for example, like Dr. Koch's lab, where you're trying to find human pathogens in, for example, human feces, where there are quite literally hundreds or thousands of bacteria, including just the one you're interested in, you might get plates that have hundreds or thousands of different species growing on them, which makes it very challenging to identify the particular microbe that you might be interested in. Well, the first step in fixing this problem came from a plant researcher named Martinus Beyerinck. And Martinus Beyerinck was looking specifically to culture a microbial species called rhizobium. Now, rhizobium grows along plant roots, and they have this symbiotic relationship where the plants supply them with nutrition, but the rhizobium also supplies the plants with the nutrition for them to survive. In fact, a huge proportion of agricultural crops rely on rhizobium or similar species in order for them to grow at all. So you can see the importance of his research. The downside is rhizobium is hard to culture in and of itself. It grows in dirt. So if you're taking dirt samples, trying to identify and grow rhizobium in what we call a pure culture, it gets really challenging because guess what's also in that dirt? Hundreds or thousands of other species of microbe. But what Dr. Beyerinck actually recognized was that rhizobium has a particularly narrow range of things it needs to survive. In other words, he knew the specific things, the bare minimum requirements for rhizobium to survive. And what he did was he created a medium that only contained those nutrients, with the thought process being that if you give the bare minimum requirements for rhizobium to survive, lots of other things won't be able to survive off of those unique requirements, the things that are unique to rhizobium. This was the first elective media. With elective media, you create a medium that favors the growth of the thing that you're interested in while disfavoring the growth of others. You're not actively trying to kill the other things, you're just not giving them what they need in order to survive. You're not giving them the particular nutrients that they need to survive. So the end result is to selectively grow, or electively grow, the thing that you're interested in. So that was one approach. Towards the beginning of the 20th century, we get researchers like Alfred McConkie, we get J.W. Churchman, and they start playing with the idea of including certain chemicals in their media. The point behind adding these chemicals is to specifically destroy things that aren't what you're interested in. So for example, Alfred McConkie was very interested in studying gut microbes, similar to what was going on in Germany in Robert Koch's lab. So Alfred McConkie creates something called McConkie media. And what he discovered with McConkie media is that if he would harvest bile salts, so bile salts are these chemicals that are produced in the guts of animals that help to break down food, but they also have antimicrobial properties. So if you're interested in microbes that can survive in the gut, well, then what you do is you create a gut-like environment on a petri dish. And that's what he did. By including bile salts, harvested from other animals, in his media, he was able to specifically culture microbes that we would call enteric bacteria or fecal coliforms, things that can live in the human gut. In this way, he could enrich his samples specifically for those things that might cause GI infections while killing off those that can't survive in the human gut and likely aren't the cause. This is what we call a selective media. Selective media includes chemicals or conditions that make it hard for other organisms to grow. In a sense, you kill those things off that don't interest you. J.W. Churchman also discovered things like crystal violet, for example. Crystal violet is a vital dye. If you include that in plates, it would be particularly harmful to the growth of gram-positive bacteria. It also kills off fungi, for example. Main reason why is this crystal violet actually kind of works its way into the cell walls of gram-positive bacteria, into the cell walls of fungi, and kills them. But it does allow other types of bacteria, particularly those that we will learn are called gram-negative bacteria, it does allow them to survive. So we start to see people around the beginning of the 20th century begin to refine our way of growing microbes in a controlled condition so we could specifically grow those things that we were interested in. And that practice continues today. By the time we got to the mid-1950s, we're starting to see people include specific antibiotics into their media. Why didn't earlier scientists think of this? Well, it's simple. We didn't have antibiotics until the 40s anyways. So it wasn't really until we got to the 40s and the 50s in the age of discovery when it came to antibiotics that we had antibiotics that were specific enough to be useful to create selective media. Now, there's another type of media that we often use that is particularly useful as well. This is what we call differential media. Differential media doesn't really control what grows. In fact, differential media does not in any way restrict what is going to grow in the plate. But what it does do is tell us some difference with respect to what is actually growing on the plate. A great example of a differential media is what we call blood agar. Blood agar is agar that has all the other nutritional requirements that most other petri dishes have. It's basically a general purpose media. It's got, the biological equivalent of chicken broth in there, proteins, sugars, so on and so forth. It's usually yeast extract and peptone and salts that allow the microbe to grow. But it also contains typically sheep's blood. And one of the things that we can do on blood agar is grow microbes and see whether or not those microbes are able to interact with red blood cells. And what we know about some pathogenic bacteria is they can secrete enzymes that do something called hemolysis. Hemolysis is the breakdown or destruction of red blood cells. This is one way we can help identify what's growing on our plates. I mean, it's not conclusive by any means, but it can help us to narrow down specifically the thing we're looking at. So blood agar is a great example of a differential media. Now, none of these classes of media are exclusive. They're not mutually exclusive. So for example, we can look at something called modified McConkie media. This is something we commonly encounter in microbiological labs. Modified McConkie media includes the following things. It includes the bile salts that Alfred McConkie originally put in there, but it also includes crystal violet. The crystal violet helps to kill off all gram-positive bacteria and also fungi that might be found in that particular sample. But it also includes a pH-sensitive dye called neutral red and a sugar called lactose. So why does McConkie media include these things? Well, the answer is simple. Certain things that live in a gut can digest lactose. Certain things can't. Those things that do digest lactose typically produce an acid byproduct. They secrete an acid, something like lactic acid, for example, as a waste product of their fermentation. When you secrete an acid into the media, it's going to cause the pH of the media surrounding those bacteria to actually change. It'll drop. The pH-sensitive dye neutral red will then react to the changing acidity, to the changing pH in the environment. So we can not only tell that if something's growing on modified McConkie media, we can tell that it's gram-negative and enteric because of the selection produced by the bile salts and the crystal violet, but we can also tell whether or not it ferments lactose based on whether or not it changes the color of the neutral red dye in the sample. McConkie media, modified McConkie, is a perfect example of a media that is both selective and differential. So what I want to do now is I want to go through five of the most common types of media that you will encounter in a microbiological lab. And we'll talk about whether they're selective, differential, both, neither. And we'll talk about what they're typically used to culture. One of the most common types of media you'll encounter in a microbiology lab is something called mueller-hinton media. Mueller-hinton media is what we call a general purpose media. It's neither selective nor differential. Pretty much anything that can grow on the nutrients provided in mueller-hinton media, which is most things that are particularly relevant to human health and disease, can grow on mueller-hinton. It's also not differential. The only thing you're going to see is the different colors and shapes and sizes of the colonies that grow on the plate. When we talk about a colony, what we're talking about is a patch of microbial growth. You can see them on the example here. Each of these colonies is actually the result of a single bacterial cell or microbial cell that then divides through binary fission to produce identical copies of itself. And that colony is actually typically unique. Is a way of can be used to identify what particular microbe is growing on that plate based on the size of the colony, the color of the colony, the texture of the colony, the elevation, so on and so forth. So Mueller-Hinton doesn't give us any selection, nor does it give us any differentiation with respect to what's growing on there. It just allows everything to grow. In that sense, it's a great media if you don't know what you're culturing and you just want stuff to grow and take a look at it. But it's not so great if you're trying to identify things. For that, we may want to turn to something called the differential media. We talked about this briefly a little earlier in the video, but let's look at blood agar. Blood agar is a terrific example of a media that is not selective, but is differential. It's essentially a Mueller-Hinton plate that has blood cells in it, red blood cells in it, typically isolated from sheep, is a very common source from this. Now, while it allows pretty much anything that could grow on Mueller-Hinton to grow on blood agar, it will also tell us some difference. It will tell us, for example, how those particular microbes or whether those particular microbes are able to interact with red blood cells, whether they can destroy them. Some bacteria demonstrate an activity. They produce enzymes that can do something called hemolysis, the breakdown of red blood cells. So there are three major types of hemolysis that we discussed. We have alpha. Alpha typically turns the area surrounding the colony green. Beta hemolysis removes all of the red surrounding the colony because they completely destroy the red blood cells. And then gamma hemolysis is really no hemolysis at all. They don't interact with the red blood cells. A great example of when we would use this is if you suspect one of your patients has strep throat. So very commonly, if your patient, you think your patient is suffering from bacterial pharyngitis, it's the technical name for strep throat, you do a throat culture and you swab it onto blood agar. If your patient does have streptococcus-based pharyngitis, you're probably looking for a particular species of streptococcus called Streptococcus pyogenes. And Streptococcus pyogenes is beta hemolytic. So you do the throat culture, you put it onto blood agar, you culture it overnight, take a look, and you look, do you have any colonies on there that are beta hemolytic? If so, that's probably the one you're most interested in. That's probably the one that's causing your patient's bacterial pharyngitis, if that is indeed the case. So blood agar is differential, but not selective. The last three types of media we'll talk about are both selective and differential. We've already talked a pretty good amount about modified McConkie media. So I'll just go over this one quickly. McConkie media is an excellent media for growing gram-negative enteric bacteria. It contains crystal violet. It contains bile salts. And these effectively mimic the gut. The bile salts mimic the gut, while as a crystal violet helps to kill off anything that's most likely not gram-negative. It won't allow most gram-positives to grow, nor will it allow fungi that could potentially be in the gut to grow either. So it is selective for those. It is also differential. It is differential in the context that it includes lactose, a fermentable sugar, and that fermentable sugar, it can either be fermented or not fermented. If the sugar is fermented, the neutral red turns like a pinkish color, and that particular pink color is an indicator that that particular microbe contains the enzyme lactase and can digest lactose. If the colonies don't turn that pink color, that means it is not a lactose fermenter, and that gives us some information about that particular microbe. Another type of media that is selective and differential and is used for growing enteric bacteria or fecal coliforms is eosine methylene blue media. EMB is what it's typically abbreviated as. Again, it uses chemicals, eosin and methylene blue, to sort of mimic the gut. The methylene blue and the eosin help to effectively kill off most gram-positive things. It effectively kills off most non-enteric bacteria as well. It is differential, the same way that McConkie media is, except it has a different appearance. So if something is able to ferment the lactose that is present, the lactose is, again, the differentiating agent. If it is able to ferment the lactose, it will create an acidic environment. That acidic environment allows the methylene blue to be taken up by the colonies, and they will now have a bluish-black color, whereas non-lactose fermenters will not have really any color at all. You can see in the example here. The last type of plate we'll talk about is what's known as mannitol-salt agar. Mannitol-salt agar is another type of selective and differential media. Mannitol salt agar is particularly used to grow bacteria that are what we would call salt tolerant. In most clinical contexts, we're typically referring to staphylococcus species. Staph species commonly live on the skin. They are able to tolerate the salty environment of the skin, whereas most bacteria are not. So mannitol salt agar contains 7.5% to 10% salt, which is not survivable by most species of bacteria. That's the selection. The differentiation comes in with the pH-sensitive dye and the inclusion of mannitol, a sugar alcohol. Some bacterial species, some staph species, are actually able to ferment mannitol. In doing so, it causes a pH change, which turns the plate yellow. The classic example of this is the pathogenic bacterium Staphylococcus aureus. If you've ever heard of MRSA, MRSA is methicillin-resistant Staphylococcus aureus, but Staph aureus is a very common pathogen that causes a host of various skin infections, but can also cause sepsis and death if it's not able to be treated. Staphylococcus aureus is a great example of something that if you grow it on mannitol salt agar, it will grow because it can tolerate the high salt concentration, but it will also ferment the mannitol and turn the plate yellow. Other species, for example, Staphylococcus epidermidis, will not cause that particular change. It will grow, but it will not be positive for mannitol fermentation and the plate will not turn yellow. Now, a lot of what we've talked about today is what we would consider to be solid media. It's grown in petri dishes, and solid media is great under most circumstances. So there are pros and cons to solid media, as well as other types of media, in particular liquid media. So let's talk about the pros and cons of both of those. Solid media is great, in particular, if you have what we would call a mixed sample. In other words, if we're taking a patient sample, whether it's a stool sample or a sputum sample or a throat culture or something like that, we know that there are going to be dozens, hundreds, even thousands of different species of bacteria and microbes that are going to be contained within that sample. This is a particular sample that you want to grow on solid media. And the main reason why is when you streak that sample out, when you grow it on solid media, the different types of microbes will grow in individual colonies. It will allow you to see how many different species you have in that particular culture, because they will grow in distinct colonies with different shapes and different sizes. And if you use a differential medium, you might even be able to say, oh, this is beta hemolytic, or this is alpha hemolytic, or this is a lactose fermenter, or this is a lactose non-fermenter, and so on and so forth. If we grow those things in liquid media, you're not going to see that. Instead, what you will just simply see is what we call turbidity or cloudiness. You'll know that stuff is growing, but there's no way to differentiate between the different species in a liquid sample. Now, the downside to solid media is this: you don't get as much growth, okay? You're gonna get small amounts of growth. In other words, small colonies typically. So it's not great if you need a large population of that particular bacterium or microbe that you're trying to study. That's where liquid media really shines. You can grow much more bacteria in a liquid culture. But what you need to do first before transferring it into liquid culture is make sure that you have a pure sample. Quite commonly, we grow things on solid media first, identify the colony or the colonies that we're interested in, and then grow those in pure culture, i.e. a sample that contains only a single species of bacteria in liquid culture. Then from those microbes in liquid culture, we can do all kinds of tests. We can harvest DNA, or we can do immunological tests with that pure culture. So there's a time and place for both, and they both have, there's a good reason why you would use solid in some cases and a good reason for using liquid in others. Now, I want to end our conversation on microbial nutrition and microbial culture by going back to the laboratory of Dr. Koch. And what I want to clarify is this: why was Dr. Koch so interested in learning all of these different techniques for culturing microbes? Why was it so important? And the main reason why, as I discussed at the beginning of this video, is Dr. Koch and his colleagues were very interested in trying to determine the specific microbial causes of given infections. How can we say that this particular disease is caused by this particular microbe? Nobody had really attempted to do that until they did. And Dr. Koch was actually incredibly successful in doing this. And he laid out a four-step process, or four criteria that must be met in order for a particular microbe to be determined definitively to be the cause of a particular type of infection. These are what we call Koch postulates, and they're still used today when we're still trying to find the source of any novel infection. Koch postulates go like this. The first step is this: the particular microbe or bacteria that you're interested in needs to be found in abundance and people suffering, or patients or animals suffering from the particular disease of interest, but it should not be found at all or in any real abundance in those individuals who are healthy. Second, you need to be able to isolate that particular microbe from those individuals and grow it in pure culture. Third, You need to be able to take that pure culture, inject it into a healthy host. And that particular microbe, that particular thing, must then cause the disease of interest. Now, I should specify, Dr. Koch was not advocating for human-based experimentation. Typically, these would be done with laboratory animals. But the bottom line is you need to be able to take that thing that you've isolated, the thing you think is the pathogen of interest, put it into a healthy host, and that then needs to cause the same disease you think is causing it. And the fourth step then is to isolate, again, that particular pathogen, that microbe, from the organisms that you've injected with it and recover it back in pure sample. So it's basically four simple steps. Find that microbe and isolate it from a sick individual. Grow that particular microbe in pure culture, inject that microbe into a healthy host, make sure that it causes the disease, and then re-isolate it. This particular Koch postulates have withstood the test of time. They've been around for over 150 years at this point, basically, and are still used today. Through this particular process, Dr. Koch's lab was actually able to identify the microbial causes of several different diseases, including tuberculosis, anthrax, and cholera. And through the work of Dr. Koch, he really propelled forward the idea of what we call germ theory, that dispelled the old myth that infections and diseases were caused by what they would call miasma or bad air. So the people in his lab, the Hesses, the Petries, the people that worked in his lab propelled microbiology forward, really making it a laboratory science that could be performed and that could make definitive discoveries that link particular pathogens and microbes to the particular diseases and infections that they cause. Thank you so much for tuning in today. I hope you guys learned a lot about the nutritional requirements for microbes and how we culture microbes in a laboratory setting. I hope to see you guys next time, and thanks for tuning in. Bye.